Good morning, everyone. So glad to see everybody here so early in the morning, especially our mayor. So glad to have the mayor here with us this morning as we talk about these really important issues, I think critical issues for our city. And I'll talk just really about Vision Zero. Cathy Tuttle is going to come and talk to you all about it, and I had the pleasure of escorting Cathy through our district a few days ago to show her some of the critical areas where we had the greatest problems. And I wanted to talk about Vision Zero because it came to my district with a lot of emphasis, because I was getting contacted by different constituents talking about their family members who had been killed just crossing the street, trying to go to the grocery store, trying to go to church in the morning. And as I started to really calculate how many people had been killed in my district alone from the time I took office, there had been 26 people in my district. And so I started to learn what is going on in my district and what can we do as a city to help improve this citywide, because the statistics in San Antonio were particularly staggering. And I started to investigate, and I came across Vision Zero, which was comes from Sweden and Europe, but in the United States, New York is the leader for Vision Zero. So I went to a conference to see how we could implement some of these changes in our city to make our streets safer, to make our community safer, and so that San Antonio wouldn't be one of the leading cities in the country for traffic fatalities. And of course, we got tremendous support from our mayor and from our city staff to try to implement these changes right away for Vision Zero. And what Vision Zero is a policy that we have zero traffic fatalities in our city. And while it's a very ambitious goal, it is possible. We have examples in our city with our Joint Base San Antonio of examples where they have zero fatalities. 80,000 people go to the military bases every day, and they have practically zero fatalities on their installations. So we know that it's possible. There are many reasons that it's difficult to enforce, but it is possible, and it is based on decisions that we make as policymakers that create these problems and in the end can resolve these problems. So I'm looking forward to the dialogue here today. I have with me a city staff, Kevin Barton. He's also my husband, but is serving as volunteer staff for me here today. And if Kevin, could you raise your hand up right here in the front? So if anybody has questions to Kevin, that we can be directed back to the office. I'm really open and anxious to hear about all of the things that we have today. So thank you all for being here and being very, very interested in this issue of Vision Zero, issues of the built environment. We know that the built environment is what can ultimately make our city safe. The mayor touched on the larger issues, air quality, water quality, transportation-related issues, and my focus here has been on Vision Zero and the reduction of pedestrian and cycling and all related traffic fatalities. So I'm anxious to hear how this day progresses and how our city changes as a result. And I have the pleasure of introducing Cathy, who I got to know on a more personal level when we went for a bike ride in our neighborhood. And I'll just talk to you a little bit about Cathy. Aside from being very innovative and giving me some very specific ideas for what we could do on our streets, she is a PhD in urban design and planning from the University of Washington and a certificate from Portland State University in bicycle facilities planning and design. She received the highest individual award from Sustainable Seattle in 2011 and the Sustainable Path Foundation Pathbreakers Award in 2012. In addition, she has served on the Seattle Mayor's School Road Safety Task Force and Seattle Public Schools Traffic Safety Committee. In 2007, Tuttle started Cascade Bicycle Club's first Easy Ride series called Spokespeople Rides. She is a ride leader and has trained over 20 ride leaders who develop monthly easy rides for all ages and abilities. So it's a great pleasure that I welcome Cathy Tuttle to come in and talk to us more about Vision Zero.
Okay. I'm getting my slides loaded, I think.
Yep.
Yep.
This is the first one. Or you can just do it here.
Which is the button? This one?
Mm-hmm. This one.
Okay.
It's down, but you can also use this too.
Okay.
The right.
Okay.
So hello, Texas. Hi. This is actually my howdy. Yeah. This is my first time in Texas. Actually, I was in the airport in Houston about 10 years ago, but first time in San Antonio for sure. And I'm feeling very welcome here and glad to be here. It's rainy, cold, 40 degrees in Seattle, and it's been like so hot in Texas. I mean, for you, it's probably the weather is perfectly reasonable, but for me, it's been really warm. So, and I also wanted to thank Councilmember Gonzalez and her husband Kevin for taking me on a ride 2 days ago. And I actually will have a little bit more information about that ride and the ride that I went on yesterday. But I wanted to start with saying the reason that I came here to San Antonio was that I have a passion for safe and healthy streets. And I wanted to come to a city where the streets, at least statistically, were killing people. This is a city that is off scale around the country in having traffic fatalities for people walking, biking, and driving. I think the rate is about four times that of Seattle. And I really literally wanted to come here to see what there was. To see, because I wanted to see a place where pedestrian safety was at so much at risk. So I came here and I saw a lot of streets like this. San Antonio is the 18th most dangerous out of 51 large metro areas in the country. Seattle actually ranks number one best for pedestrian safety. And I expected to see a lot of this. And so I've been here for 3 days now, and what did I find in the last 3 days? Well, what I found was you have a beautiful city. Of course, your river walk is extraordinary, but your downtown is pretty spectacular too. You've kept your stock of historic buildings in beautiful condition. You have small businesses that are doing really well. Your streets are really well maintained, and I'm very impressed with your benches, your covered bus stops, your curb ramps, your traffic signals, your sidewalk maintenance. Your downtown is a very healthy place. Well, except you have a mind-boggling number of parking garages. And I've heard a lot about the wild dogs. I have not seen the wild dogs, but I'm like terrified by the wild dogs now. The other thing I observed was that people in Texas really do observe, compared to Seattle at least, obey road signs. People look at stop bars when they're stopping in intersections. Drivers are courteous. I mean, it's a courteous place. And the other thing I noticed too was that you really respect your elders in your city design. You provide places, benches all over the place, benches at every bus stop for people to sit. You provide covered places for people. This is a city that respects its people. And I noticed too, I went on two different bike rides, that drivers respect people who are biking. The people really are observing that 3 foot, give people 3 feet passing law. That you know, I didn't hear as I do when I drive, when I bike around in other cities, you know, people like gunning their motors, trying to get past us. You know, maybe bikers are people on bikes are such a rare thing to see that drivers just look at us and think, oh my gosh, there's something so odd in the road, I need to really slow down and pay attention to it. But people were paying attention to us as we were biking, and I was impressed by that. You also have some absolutely gorgeous infrastructure for people on bikes and people walking, including this beautiful bridge and spectacular trails, the multi-use trails on Mission Reach, and then the whole kind of river set of trails is world class. So you have a lot going for you. And even in Councilmember Gonzalez's district in District 4, the streets there, you know, they don't have sidewalks, but they're well maintained. I mean, these are streets that, you know, the paving is, there are not many potholes. Relative to the rest of America, there are not many potholes in San Antonio. The vegetation is well cared for. It looks a little overgrown. I mean, it's a poor neighborhood, but it's a street that's well maintained. It's a street where the city is doing its job. So I've ridden now a bike on the east side, the west side, the Mission Reach, the Pearl District. Yesterday I did a bike ride with this group of very dedicated San Antonio City staff and advocates. They were all very comfortable riding here. And pictured here, I just wanted to mention, are Yvette, who runs the women's ride on first Tuesdays, Jillian from City Transportation Planning, Jeff, who runs all of the San Antonio Tuesday night bike rides, Kristen, who runs Earn a Bike Co-op, Jack from Bike Texas, me and Ali Blazowski, who's the bicycle and pedestrian coordinator of the Alamo MPO. I also spent time yesterday with Bert from San Antonio Walks and Nikki and Brandon from San Antonio Parks and Recreation, who are working on your trails program. So altogether, a really excellent group of people that I spent time with. I also did a radio show with David Strong on the Source, and so met a lot of San Antonio, got to see a lot of San Antonio, and you have a city that really makes people feel comfortable. In fact, when we were on the Source, David and I, we got a couple of callers who were saying what a terrible city San Antonio was, and I felt really, really awful because you have a great city. I really want to emphasize that you are doing things really, really well. So why are so many people being maimed and dying on San Antonio streets? Why are your streets failing to keep your people alive? 54 people died walking in San Antonio last year. 800 people were involved in major life-changing crashes in your city. These are serious, epidemic levels of traffic violence. Czar Zamora is an epidemic. These streets are engineered to fail at safety. Most of the traffic violence happening in San Antonio is happening on overly wide streets and often on streets that are owned by the state of Texas. To stop traffic violence, you desperately need these streets to function as places for people. 9 people died on this street, Culebra, I think it is, in the last 2 years, including 2 elders who were going to the Basilica in this picture. All cities need streets that are safe for traveling, and thriving cities, like San Antonio, which is a really thriving city, needs streets where people want to linger, needs places that make people healthy, and needs streets that don't divide us. Streets can be places that actually root us into our homes. San Antonio is really lovely, but it's filled with streets like this. These are the streets where people die. There is so much that is good in San Antonio. You clearly have traffic engineers who know how to maintain streets and build safe street crossings. They install benches. They make a good city. And thanks to the mayor and council member Gonzalez and the rest of the council, you've got a Vision Zero ordinance for traffic safety. You've got politicians, you've got money from your council. And so what I've heard over the last 2 days is that there's a pushback from, so you have the leg of the council and the politicians, you have a leg of really effective city people, but what I'm hearing is that you need that third leg of the stool, the community, that's fearful of traffic safety improvements in the face of this overwhelming traffic violence. So in Seattle, we have pushback too about traffic safety improvements. I mean, every city in America is going through this kind of growing up of turning their streets into 21st century places. But we've made a lot of progress, and I wanted to tell you more about what we're doing in Seattle to see if there are any lessons you can learn from us. I mean, I'm offering them humbly because you can't export one city's ideas to another, you know, wholly, but I think there's some probably good ideas of what we've done in Seattle that you might want to think about in your city. I wanted to tell you about our model of community engagement, because that is the leg of your stool that you're missing. We have really good politicians, really good finances, good traffic engineers in our city, but we also have really good community who are kind of joining the cause of building safe streets. So this is more about what we're doing. And I also wanted to tell you a little bit about my organization, which is called Seattle Neighborhood Greenways, a very long name. And my staff keeps on saying, make it a shorter name, you know, call it like, you know, Good Streets or something like that. And I haven't made that change because we are very neighborhood related. So first of all, I wanted to tell you what a greenway was in the Seattle language. In San Antonio, your greenways are the beautiful trails that go along your creeks. And in Seattle, neighborhood greenways are residential streets that are slowed to 20 miles an hour. This is a typical Seattle street, very parked up with cars. And in fact, one of the ways that streets are slowed to 20 miles an hour is by narrowing them. These parked cars actually serve as a way of narrowing the street so people can't go much more than 20 miles an hour on it. And you'll look at our street maintenance or our sidewalk maintenance. We don't do nearly as good a job as you do in San Antonio. I'm looking at that broken piece of sidewalk there. But how we maintain streets at 20 miles an hour is adding curb bumps or speed humps. People, not curb bumps, speed humps. Usually two along each block, and they're engineered to slow cars to 20 miles per hour. When they first go in, people who drive don't like them very much. People don't like to go 20 miles an hour, but it's the thing that you really need to encourage people to do on residential streets, where children play, where elders gather, where people want to cross the street. It's a reasonable speed for people to go in a residential area. We're working on getting a 20 mile an hour blanket speed area in Seattle on all residential streets, and a 25 mile an hour speed limit on all arterial streets, which is pretty radical, but it's actually what New York City has done too. So we'd like to have that happen in Seattle in the next 2 years or so. And there is pushback. There's definitely community pushback to have that happening. The other thing about neighborhood greenways, these are residential streets. The residential streets are located one off of the main arterial street, so that they go along the commercial corridors where people have businesses, where the schools are, where the libraries are, where the transit stops are, so that people can walk or bike if they want that quieter, more traffic-controlled way to go in a parallel way beside the busy commercial street. They work really effectively. We have about 20 miles of neighborhood greenways in Seattle. We're scheduled to get another 60 over the next few years, and I'll tell you a little bit more about that. Oh, the other thing about neighborhood greenways is they're stop controlled, so the people walking and biking are controlled by the people driving can't go zipping across the greenway. And then the big cost of putting in neighborhood greenways is when they come to intersections. It's expensive to put in traffic signals. In Seattle, we pay probably twice what you pay here in San Antonio. We pay $500,000 for a traffic signal. We're fighting about the cost all the time, but it's a pricey thing to get across a big commercial street. And so that's the big cost of putting in a greenway, is because you're doing that one off of the main arterial, you still need to get across all of the other commercial streets as you're going. And actually, Kevin asked me about greenways, if they were, Kevin Barton here, if they were effective. They're incredibly effective at, this is a chart of how many more people are biking on the greenway over a year. So the red line is people in 2013, I think that is, and then the blue line is people in 2014 biking. So it's quadrupled the number of people biking on these streets. This is another one. So my organization, Seattle Neighborhood Greenways, is a community coalition group that's divided into 19 very micro-level neighborhood associations. We also, just as of this year, have council districts, 7 council districts, and so we've kind of clustered all of those community organizations into their council districts. Our organization is just 4 years old. We've only got 3 full-time staff, but we've got hundreds of volunteers. We have a mailing list of 5,000 or 6,000, and we're always focused on that micro-level community organization of affiliated people who are passionate about safe streets and reclaiming streets for people. So what do these groups do? Last night I pulled up a Facebook sampling of a random set of these local coalition groups to see what they're up to. This is Lake City Greenways. It's turning a street right-of-way into a park. Queen Anne, or actually that's Rainier Valley Greenways, is taking their district council member on a walk. And also Queen Anne Greenways is taking their district council member on a walk. These are newly elected leaders, so they want to meet them and, you know, show them the traffic safety issues in their communities. The Central Seattle Greenways is hosting Cranksgiving, which is a bike ride food drive. And Greenwood Finney Greenways is actually collaborating with Lake City Greenways and Lichtenhaller Greenways, and they're planning to audit, do safe routes to school engineering audits for 5 elementary schools with the hopes of getting sidewalks around those elementary schools in the next 2 years. All of these people, all those last set of slides, are volunteers. Those are all people who are passionate about safe streets. So my organization, Seattle Neighborhood Greenways, is really a hardcore lobbying organization masquerading as a coalition of community groups. In the past 4 years, we have directly influenced $40 million in engineering improvements in Seattle. We've got new signals, new greenways, road rechannelizations, or road diets, as some people call them, and new city safety programs and staff. Our power as community groups to make change comes from our grassroots and from being focused on the local needs, the very local needs, and representing very local interests of our 19 micro groups to city government. We have educated literally thousands of people on the ideas of complete streets and Vision Zero. We managed to get a bicycle master plan adopted with 250 miles of safe streets, and that plan was developed almost entirely with crowdsourced mapping. That means that the community developed the bicycle master plan, and we're getting about half of those bicycle master plan miles built with a $930 million transportation levy that we helped to define and get passed just last week. That's that Move Seattle levy. So who joins this community organization of Safe Streets? Well, it's a lot of parents, particularly people who have been biking in Seattle. So we have about 4% of our population bikes to work. And people on bikes, once they have children, or often men, once they have girlfriends, say, I can't bike anymore with my girlfriend. I can't bike anymore with my kids because the roads aren't safe enough. And so they come to our organization and say, how can we work with you to build a safer place? Parents also really care about their kids getting safely to school. We have a lot of elders who want to walk safely. We have a lot of healthcare professionals in our organization. And then because we're Seattle, we have Facebook, we have Amazon, we have Microsoft. We have a lot of technical people coming to us and saying, we want a city where we can put down some roots. We want a place where we have a place where young people want to actually kind of grow from their 20s when they first join Amazon and Microsoft and Google, and we want them to settle here. And the way that they want to settle here is not with cars, but with a city where you can walk and bike and ride a bus comfortably. And then when you need a car, you can get it from Uber or Lyft, and you know, you're done. So people in this generation, in Seattle at least, don't want to own cars. And in fact, they don't want driver's licenses either, which drives me crazy because I have a 18-year-old, a 21-year-old, and my 21-year-old's boyfriend, and none of them have driver's licenses. And so who ends up driving whenever somebody needs to drive in my household? It's me, because again, this is a trend among young people, especially among the kind of the high-tech community. People don't want to drive anymore. And so we need to build the cities that can actually help that. So these are the people who are part of our coalition, and these are people who really care about the city they live in. So I wanted to talk to you about two of the programs that we're working on that I thought would be most applicable to San Antonio. One is about our Memorial Walks program, and then one is about the language that we've been teaching people to use about traffic violence. So the Memorial Walks and Solutions Meetings program is something that we do for all fatalities that happen on our streets in Seattle. In Seattle, we have 15 at the most. I think last year it was 13 fatalities on our streets. We don't have the kind of carnage that you do in San Antonio. So we actually, it's true. But Memorial Walks and Solutions Meetings have been our most effective advocacy tools, not only because they make change, but they've actually changed the way people think about traffic violence. So I'm going to tell you about, first of all, the very first Memorial Walk and Solutions Meeting that we organized. And it follows this very classic arc of a terrible tragedy, an effective solution, and some positive outcomes that came out of this terrible tragedy. This story started in the spring of 2013, when Dennis and Judy Schulte went on a walk with their daughter-in-law, actually, Karina, and her infant son, Elias. This was their first grandchild, and the Schultes had just relocated to Seattle. It was a beautiful, clear day, and the mom, the baby, and the grandparents crossed busy Northeast 75th Street across four very ill-defined lanes that drivers routinely wove and sped on. A drunk driver with multiple DUIs sped towards the Schultes, instantly killing the grandparents and leaving Karina and her infant son in critical condition. Mm-hmm. We're an advocacy organization, and you know, we'd only formed about a year and a half before this, and when we saw this, we saw a terrible tragedy, but we also saw an opportunity to educate the community about traffic violence, and to not blame it on a drunk driver, but to actually talk about other conditions, the fact that there was a four-lane road where people routinely sped, and this four-lane road, in fact, exactly the spot where the Schulte family had been killed, was right in front of a middle school. It was a place where there were frequent collisions, where there were frequent serious injuries. And so we approached the Schulte family, and we asked their permission to do a memorial walk and a solutions meeting. This is the first time that we did one of those. We're very good, Seattle Neighborhood Greenways is, with PR. And this tragedy brought together hundreds of people. We produced this event within a week after the collision. We invited the media, the mayor, police, traffic engineers, the family and friends of the Schulte family. Now remember, this street was one where people routinely were weaving, where there'd been multiple acts of traffic violence, and where there had been pushback from the community on making changes to this street. We looked at this as an opportunity to actually address what was going on that street and to turn something valuable out of this awful tragedy. So one of the first things we did was that we made sure that the mayor of Seattle could meet with the family. Something we've learned through doing now 15 of these memorial walks and solutions meetings is that we won't do them unless we have the full and complete buy-in of the family. I mean, it's about the victim and the victim's family. It's about respecting the fact that somebody has died here and that they're willing to take this step to actually put themselves out in public. And one thing I want to say about, at least in Seattle, that people who die, they're hounded by the media. Again, we don't have the same level of traffic violence as you do in San Antonio, but you know, this is actually a way of people controlling the media a little bit after their families have been killed. But at any rate, we brought the mayor along. He talked to the man who had his family ripped from him in this act of traffic violence. And then another thing we do is we actually take the same or a block or so of the same walk of the person who died. So we actually go some of that distance. We walk in their footsteps so we understand what happened. We see with our own eyes instead of looking at what happened on a piece of paper. We explore it, what happened with a whole community. And we ended the walk at the site where Dennis and Judy Schulte had been killed. Again, I really want to acknowledge the suffering of families who've had their lives torn apart by traffic violence. And I also wanted to call out families who've allowed us to put their grief out in public. Because change has happened because of these memorial walks and solutions meetings. So this was the first time we did a solutions meeting. It immediately followed the walk. So we did a walk with the family, we had the media, we had the mayor, and then immediately after we went to the middle school that was beside the place where the Schultes had been killed. And because of the raw power of grief and the presence of a very broad cross-section of community leaders, and I wanted to actually have you take a look at this Chief Traffic Engineer Dong Ho Chang, because he'll show up in a later slide. But we were able to hold the city accountable for quick and effective solutions. They had seen the place with their own eyes. They had walked with the family in their footsteps. And because we had reacted so quickly, the community was not, well, they still pushed back a little, but there was not as much pushback about rechannelizing the road, slowing the road from a, you know, crazy four-lane, you know, super highway through this community into a very moderately controlled, well, I'll show you, I think, yes.
And the street that we did this work on had 5 walking fatalities in the past 7 years. And the community that we approached about this said, oh, you know, we've got memorials, we don't think anything will come of it. Yeah, sure, we'll do a candlelight vigil. And I said, no, this is being accompanied by a solutions meeting. So the man in the, that's not a cowboy hat, probably, I think so. I don't know, maybe it is. Anyway, he's a Tlingit elder himself and a shaman. He did a kind of a blessing ceremony at the area. And the person that was very instrumental in making things happen is City Council Member Tom Rasmussen, who also chaired the Transportation Committee of the City Council, actually made it happen. And again, this street, this is the solutions meeting following with James St. Clair's relatives, the mayor's staff, city staff, reporters, and this street is currently being rechannelized in much the same way with 2 travel lanes, 1 center turn lane, and it's in construction as we speak. So it takes a year, of course. You can't always expect a 6-month turnaround on a dangerous 4-lane street, but it happens. It happens because the power of the community is harnessed in a very effective way with the media, the local community, the politicians, the police, and then other interested parties who all come together to actually work on solutions. We also have done these events for people who bike, so led by bike riders going on the same path that the person traveled. This one was very close to the port of Seattle. You can see that in the background. And the port got very involved with this, has made changes to its roadway, actually did a whole workshop on how people who do truck deliveries for the port see bikes or don't see people on bikes. And they've been a huge partner in making a safer area for commuters here, for bike commuters. And of course, we had the media, and of course, we invited the mayor. You'll notice too, on the signal where it says detour route, there's a white bike, a ghost bike, and this is something that typically goes up in Seattle after bicycle fatalities. And we've been looking around for things to put on the ground after pedestrian fatalities. And this is actually from New York, an organization called Right of Way. This is what they put on places where people have died walking on the street. And we're working with an artist right now on something to put on the street for people who die. I think it's a great kind of reminder for people to pay attention on the street, and also a way of memorializing someone in the place where they died. So this is going, the first time we used this is for Leo Almazar, who was a janitor who worked in downtown Seattle, was hit by a speeding vehicle. This is his family. And you know, to kind of summarize what's going on with memorials, they're really challenging to do. They take a lot of time. 40 hours of either a dedicated volunteer or sometimes 20 hours of dedicated volunteer and 20 hours of my time to actually make these things happen, because you need to be working with people in a very sensitive way. But they obviously result in excellent outcomes. We actually have a sort of a how to do memorial events on our website. And do remember that the idea of memorials is first honoring the victim. The challenges of doing them, of course, are staying very sensitive to grieving families and then getting information in a timely enough way to actually produce them in a time where you can touch the community, which means that you need to know about fatalities and what happened around them within a week or so after they happened. The other thing that Mary, you probably appreciate this too, is that if you're an elected person, you like to speak, usually. And so we always make an opportunity for whatever political leaders are there to speak. This is our current mayor, Mayor Ed Murray. And this is the former mayor, Mayor Mike McGinn. But we always give the mayor the microphone. It's a way of owning what happened, and it's a way of honoring the fact that a politician cares enough to be there to help. And once they get quoted about this traffic violence act, they get involved. So it's very important to keep the mayor involved. This is also our mayor, Ed Murray, and our new transportation director, Scott Kubley, is the sort of balding guy on the right side of the slide. I also wanted to say that an unexpected benefit of this has been getting to know the city and the cultures of the city in a very intimate way. I've met people from Tlingit, from Oromo, from the Hispanic community, and it's also kind of a great way to break cities out of the silo kind of thinking and finding solutions that work really quickly. And it's also a great way to get people who engineer streets and first responders to get them honored and noticed. This is the result of that last. It's again another road rechannelization that came out of that tragedy. This is another road rechannelization. This is a Nepali woman who died about a year ago. So traffic violence. So its biggest threat is not actually the instance of death, but the fact that people don't use streets anymore for active living. We avoid walking and biking in places that we perceive of as dangerous. Our memorial rides aim to change the cultural paradigm that defines the automobile as the only normal way of getting around. We've adopted Vision Zero in Seattle. We did this in February, so we're not that far ahead of you. Just some more ideas about Vision Zero, and I'm looking at the time, and I only have another 10 minutes. So I'm gonna cruise through the rest of my slides, but I hope you got some ideas about how you might turn the tremendous number of tragedies that you're having in San Antonio into something more purposeful. I mean, I'm sure you're thinking about that, but I hope that you got some ideas about solutions meetings and memorials and using them in a way that respects the victim, the victim's family, and actually makes change in the city. The other thing I wanted to quickly talk to you about is road-tested language, how we've been talking to people about traffic violence and how we've been talking to them about alternate modes of transportation. We don't call when a car runs into a person and kills them, we don't call it an accident. We call it a collision or a crash, very important. We don't say the car hit the person because the car didn't hit the person. A person driving the car hit another person. So a car crashes into a crib, probably not. A driver crashed into the crib. The Bellevue baby was unhurt. The only time that cars actually act by themselves are self-driving cars. So, yeah, police cars don't kill. Police driving police cars sometimes kill. The other thing is people who bike. So I slip into it myself sometimes and call myself a biker, but I'm not a biker. These are bikers. These are cyclists. And these are people who bike. People who bike are people. And it's important to call that out because it's a way of humanizing who we are as we use the street. If we call people bikers, if we call them cyclists, if we call street violence an accident, we suddenly change the whole language of how we're approaching Vision Zero, how we're approaching traffic safety. And I think we can make that change in our language pretty easily. These are pedestrians, these are people who walk. So watch yourself when you're writing, when you're speaking, and start to talk about people when you're talking about road users. We often talk about transportation options. That's a very fuzzy Germany word. I think the best way to talk about it is saying that you're choosing the best way for you and your family to get around the city. It's good to use familiar and concrete words like, I'm parking my bike at the library, I'm waiting at the bus stop, I'm dropping the kids off at school. This is the language of transportation options. It doesn't overwhelm people to think about it. And I'm going to cruise through this. The other thing I wanted to mention is that these are some of the signs that our streets are changing, and some of the work that we've done is really changing. So we're putting in a lot of parklets and streeteries on parking places, painting rainbow crosswalks. And actually, we had a whole crosswalk, gorilla crosswalk painting action that the city decided to sort of own, which I'm really glad for. This is a protected bike lane, 2,000 feet of it actually, that was built by the community out of orange cones, duct tape, and green butcher paper. Actually, this is on the most dangerous street in Seattle. This is another community-led project where they collected evidence that people actually stopped. This is going to be built by the city because the community actually put it up and said, this is working really well. So we do a lot of these kinds of projects that the city then adopts and puts into practice. This is the best indicator of success in Seattle. We have a Seattle Family Biking Group that's now up to 1,200 members, and people are feeling safe enough to bike with their children in the city. So San Antonio. So Kevin Barton made me take this picture. He said, it's the best traffic safety calming that we have in downtown, and it is. I think that, you know, people stop here. This is a place where people driving respect people walking. You actually control traffic here. And I also wanted to mention that we've given over the shaping of our cities to engineers, with rare exception. We defer to traffic engineers rather than to you. Your voice and your vision of San Antonio matters. If you're the parent of small children, an artist, a small business owner, a doctor, a historian, a nurse, a scientist, an honored elder, or a public health practitioner, there are so many voices that are muted by the overwhelming voices of traffic engineers. We need the traffic engineers. They solve our problems. But the problem that they need to solve is getting you a more safe and livable San Antonio.
Cathy, as you may or may not know, the Alamo Area MPO developed a pedestrian safety action plan in February of 2012. I was curious whether you received a copy of that.
I have not read that, no.
I'm sure that Ali Blosky, she's in here, will get you a copy. But we had, at that particular time, we were tagged to Focus City because 12% of all roadway fatalities in the United States are pedestrian, but in San Antonio it's 20%. And it has a definite impact on our funding. And so we used a consultant out of your neck of the wood, Tool and Associates, spent a year and a half developing that. But I will make sure you get a copy of that.
Okay, thank you. And you know, we have a branch of Tool in Seattle, so they're a good firm. There's two more. That was not a question.
Good morning, Kathy. I saw that kind of street section when you talk about street diets, reducing the miles per hour on the streets. One thing that I've in our street, we live in downtown, it's kind of a development street. We're asking almost to do the same thing, widen our sidewalks but the one thing that we kind of run into in the city is that, you know, there's always a concern of the fire trucks. You know, how do we get the fire truck in the space when everything is sort of narrow? And I was hoping you could just kind of talk about some of your experiences with sort of the that kind of scenario.
Sure, we work with fire safety all the time. And so what they need is, if you're doing a curb bump, that's one of the things they don't like, is to make it narrow enough so that if it's a fire route, that their wheelbase can go over it. I mean, that's the simplest thing. And you know, the firefighting establishment, they are first responders and they're very interested in traffic safety and Vision Zero. I mean, they pulled enough dead people off of roadways that they don't want to have to do it again. So they are actually incredibly supportive of this action. They just need to be accommodated. And actually turns as well is something else that we work on with them. So we do rolled curbs for them to make those turns on fire routes. There was another question. Yes.
Is it okay to, this is primarily a comment though, so, but you might have ideas too, thank you. And I wrote it down. This is a great conference, I absolutely love it. In the past 10 years, I have had the honor and an opportunity to be involved in a lot of conferences like this and community discussions. You mentioned community pushback. Last year, there was a pushback from a small contingent of citizens who didn't want the bike lane on South Flores in District 3. The City of San Antonio staff, it was based on MPO, a study that cost a lot of money. There was all kinds of support, technically, for this bike lane. A few citizens decided that it slowed down their morning and afternoon travel. And so the council, and I want to say thank you very much to City Council Member Gonzalez, because she was the only one, to my understanding, that voted against it. The council allowed the pushback of a few individuals, and they used money that, it's my understanding, and I hope I'm wrong, that the money that they used to remove it was identified to build bicycle facilities. Now, I might be wrong with that, I hope I am. And bicycle facilities, we know, slows down traffic. There's two schools on that portion of South Flores. There's an elementary school and there's a high school.
So I did hear about this situation, and I, you know, we have had similar situations in Seattle where people push back and don't want change. In fact, every one of those road revitalizations, those road diets that I showed you, there was plenty of community pushback. What I'm talking about is developing a strong enough advocacy community to actually influence the other council members to say, yes, we are strong enough. This is the kind of city we want to evolve into. We want to be a safe city. We don't want to be a city. You know, we want a place where new tech businesses settle. We want to, and this is only going to happen if you have that other community that's speaking up against that. I mean, you can influence your mayor and city council by actually showing them that you have those voices. I understand the situation. I understand that, you know, according to the data, that lane shouldn't have been pulled out, but I also understand that they're responding to the politics of it, and that's rational too. So you need to build up the other side of the political equation.
All right, thank you.
Sorry, that's all. We can talk after. I'll be around.